The Egyptian obelisk at St. Peter's Square of the Vatican may function as a datum, with the surrounding windrose markers indicating important directions. This array at the Vatican seems to define a unique spatial relationship between two of the most famous sites of the ancient world, including Chartres Cathedral and Lalibela, Ethiopia, the home to many rock-hewn churches. Here we'll see how the array at St. Peter's uses the windrose markers to point to both places. And in addition, both places seem to have a unique relationship to the Ark of the Covenant as stated in the Old Testament, while Chartres Cathedral displays carvings of the Queen of Sheba bringing the Ark of the Covenant to Ethiopia. Legend holds it that the Ark once rested in Lalibela, Ethiopia. So the fact that these two are pointed to by both the southeast and northwest windrose markers at the array at the Vatican is terribly interesting and may indicate a hidden link between the two places. Thanks for joining me here at Geomantic Information Systems as we explore the mysteries of the Vatican, Lalibela, and Chartres Cathedral. Thank you very much. In order to understand the legacy of the Ark of the Covenant and the effect it's had on different secret societies and religions, we must examine the Temple Mount and the Old Testament tale of the Queen of Sheba visiting King Solomon. And it states this in the Old Testament, the Queen of Sheba came to Jerusalem to visit King Solomon, and at this time, they might have had a love affair or been involved with each other, because the Queen of Sheba was known to have had the son of King Solomon, Menelik I. And also in the Old Testament, it does state that King Solomon gave the Ark of the Covenant to the Queen of Sheba, and she took it to Ethiopia. So here we have the Queen of Sheba bringing the Ark to her kingdom, possibly to Marib, Yemen, a city that she reportedly had created and had one of the biggest dams of the ancient world that made the region flower and be good for agriculture. And the Ark then could have made its way to Ethiopia, where we see author Graham Hancock writing his book, The Sign and the Seal, that tells the tale of how the Ark of the Covenant is located at Aksum, Ethiopia. So there is a clear tradition in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church of the Ark of the Covenant being there, and each Ethiopian Orthodox Church has a reproduction of the Ark of the Covenant. And we also see the ancient city of Lalibela, Ethiopia, being built by Mescal Lalibela as a reproduction of Jerusalem. And this in the minds of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and subsequently the faith of Rastafari, also values Lalibela as Mount Zion, or the region of Zion mentioned in the Bible, and they value this version of it. So this is an interesting association, and the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and Rastafari are interesting religions in that they developed modes of Christianity beyond the scope of the Roman Church. And this is a lot of people point to texts like the Nag Hammadi texts and other sources of Christianity that weren't meddled with or changed by the Romans to fit their needs. And the entire Ethiopian Orthodox and Rastafari faith are like this. And this also makes it interesting from a historical perspective, because we see twice in history, once in the late 19th century and once in the 1930s, did we see Italy attempting to invade Ethiopia, and only the onset of World War II, the second time, made this a failure for them. So each time the warriors of the Ethiopian nation have fought off or somehow managed to expel the invaders. Now, what we are likely seeing here in this distribution of octagonal structures across the face of the earth is kind of the marking of a prime meridian in a spiritual or talismanic manner, but also many practical uses for legally describing property. But what this all leads to is a value of the Tower of the Winds in Athens, Greece. These octagonal structures were likely inspired by the Tower of the Winds, and we see this appreciation and veneration even being carried out in 18th century England, where we see members of secret societies or exclusive groups of gentlemen creating reproductions of the Tower of the Winds that function in the same way. And this would not be unusual for emperors Justinian I and II to value the Greek culture, because the Byzantine Empire were Greek-speaking and Greek-writing cultures, and it was really almost a Romanized version of the more ancient Greek culture. So we see the Tower of the Winds, likely built in the 1st or 2nd century B.C. by Andronicus of Cyrus, also containing a clepsydra or water clock, and likely could be used to measure longitude at an early date in history when this was thought not to be able to do, and then possibly allowing people to compare their point on the earth to the Tower of the Winds using celestial sightings or star sightings. So even the tale of the Ark of the Covenant may involve the octagons of the Byzantine and Greek cultures, and this also later leads to a value of this in North America. We see the Powder Magazine, Jefferson's Poplar Forest, the Newport Tower, and the International Peace Garden all being enmeshed in this web of veneration for the Tower of the Winds, and it allows the makers of these systems to have a secret way of communicating locations or possibly having some spiritual or talismanic meaning in knowing which way to face to pray towards that point, or to enact magic or some sort of sorcery in their minds as well. We do see this activity descending from the augur class of the Roman Empire, where they even had an official or a high augur priest named an Adel that managed the orientation and building of temples. So there is a secrets enmeshed with this, and as I said, it's all related to the Byzantine or Roman form of masonry before it becomes modern and gains the aspects that it does have today.
another important point to make here, or observation to make, would be the value of Zion in the many different groups that value these kind of systems or are situated along them. By chance, we have Lalibela being considered the Zion of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and the faith of Rastafari. And then along the opposite azimuth, as it transects France, we have a clear appreciation of the concept of Zion via the bloodline of Christ or the Merovingian dynasty and other offshoot groups of that, including possibly the Knights Templar and or Priory of Zion, if it indeed exists. And through the separation of the English and or Norman factions from the French factions in 1188 at the famous cutting of the Elm incident in Gisors, we may see in France and England the same tradition having somewhat of a split, while people involved still having respect and regard for each other, but developing in slightly different ways on each side of the English Channel. And on the French side, we see the Rennes Chateau mystery and all the associated lore and mythology of the Knights Templar, the Cistercian Order, and possibly the Priory of Zion or some similar group. And we also see this in England, possibly with Sir Francis Dashwood and Admiral Anson, who created their Tower of the Winds, and also the Mount Stuart estate there, built by the Lord of Londonderry in about 1800, displaying a value of this. And later, after the era of the 18th century, we see in the 19th century the development of groups such as the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, or the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. And I've noted in my other work about Mount Shasta and California how Joaquin Miller, famous poet of the Sierras, indeed saw much success in England as an author and spent a lot of time with members of the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood and may have brought back some of the concepts they used in establishing an axis on his property in Oakland, California. So see my article at survivalcell.blogspot.com about Mount Shasta and the origins of the New Age for that. But also earlier in American history, we also see the Zion concept possibly making its way here via the Newport Tower and the Powder Magazine in Colonial Williamsburg, which both resemble the Tower of the Wind somewhat. And were built at a time earlier, actually, than the reproductions in England. So we have a value of Zion tied into all this. We discussed how the fortress of Gisors is an octagon and points an even azimuth to Mount Zion in Jerusalem. In addition to this interesting alignment between Gisors and Mount Zion, we also have the cities of Lalibela and Axum, where the Ark of the Covenant is located, creating an alignment that seems to point at the Dome of the Rock. So we have the reproduction of Jerusalem built by Mescal Lalibela and the location of the Ark of the Covenant today, creating an alignment that points back to the Temple Mount and also crosses just to the east of Mount Zion itself. So here's another symbolic alignment involved in this whole mystery. So there we have the Lalibela to Chartres Cathedral ley line that passes over the Egyptian obelisk at the center of St. Peter's Square. Please see my other work for the other places that the array at St. Peter's points to. Most interestingly, to the east, it points right to the dome of the Hagia Sophia. But in this case, we have it pointing to the northwest to Chartres Cathedral. We have other azimuths pointing to the Schönbrunn Palace in Vienna and Aachen Cathedral, another octagon also included within the Templum of the Vatican itself. So we have a fascinating grid of datums, with some of them pointing to each other, like the Tower of the Wind seems to point an azimuth to Avebury Stone Circle in England, or an earthen circle, which may be an earlier axis that was used. And see my video about that also, how Avebury behaves as a hexagonal axis. And the Rennes-le-Château mystery itself, with the chapel possibly creating an octagonal axis based on the stations of the cross, and the octagonal representation of that within the chapel at Rennes-le-Château. To find out more about mysterious alignments and occult architecture, please see my blog, survivalcell.blogspot.com. My latest book, Axis Mundi, is available there. It does not include the Shugborough Hall and West Wickham information, and I am in the middle of completing another book about that, so stay tuned soon. Also, stay tuned for an upcoming appearance with a roundtable on geomancy on Red Ice Radio, featuring me, Court Lindahl, John Cale, talking about the star map of Charleston, South Carolina, as well as David Truman, who explores geomancy in South America, and has also written an article in True History Journal, and we will possibly have John Cale writing an article as well soon in True History Journal. So thank you all very much for being here. I really appreciate it. Come back and see me soon. See my other movies about Saints Marie de la Mer and more. Have a great day out there.